This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Who is this?
Who are you trying to reach?
What number is this?
What number are you trying to reach?
I don't know.
I think you have the wrong number.
Do I?
It happens. Take it easy.
Wait. Don't hang up.
What?
I want to talk to you for a second.
They've got 900 numbers for that.
Why don't you want to talk to me?
Who is this?
You tell me your name. I'll tell you mine.
I don't think so.
What's that noise?
Popcorn.
You're making popcorn?
Uh-huh.
I only eat popcorn while listening to podcasts.
I'm getting ready to listen to a podcast now.
Really? What?
Just some Star Wars podcasts.
Do you like Star Wars podcasts?
Uh-huh.
What's your favorite Star Wars podcast?
I don't know.
You have to have a favorite.
The Trade Federation. You know, the one with the guys that stock Star Wars collectibles. What's yours?
Guess.
Beltway Banthas?
Is that the one where the guys talk politics and Star Wars?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that one, but it's not my favorite.
So tell me your favorite.
I will after you tell me your name.
Why do you want to know my name?
Because I want to know who I'm looking at.
What did you say?
Go to the back door and turn on the porch light.
I don't want to.
Do it!
Misa, so happy! It's Starships, Sabers, and Scoundrels Halloween! Happy Halloween!
Happy Halloween, scoundrels. Here's what we have in store for this week's show. Marvel has announced the new ongoing Star Wars title that will replace Darth Vader. Taxus and I are pleased. We'll discuss this and other recent stories in this week's news. November is just a week away. Therefore, it is time for another edition of Sky Stalking. Taxus will let us all know where to find the Star Wars celebrities next month. Since Halloween is coming up, we've decided to discuss one of the spookiest Star Wars stories ever told. We'll review Death Troopers and our hypothetical. Afterwards, we'll tell some Star Wars Halloween stories of our own. As always, we have collected our emails and will respond in Silence Fools. It must be October because there is some spooky stuff going on around here. Thanks for joining us for this episode of Starships, Sabers, and Scoundrels.
I so love Halloween time.
It's that time of year when all the goose and ghouls come out.
Ooh, they scare me.
Aren't you a Sith Lord? How are you afraid of those things?
Well, I just barely got my license. I had to work in school at odd times.
Wait, you went to school for that?
Yeah, it's not a popular degree program.
I can imagine. Are there any monsters you aren't scared of?
Yeah, vampires.
Oh, why's that? Is it because they look human?
No, it's because they went to the same school I did.
Don't say it.
Nice school.
Yeah.
But yeah, I know the monster everyone is actually afraid of, but they usually don't see it until after Halloween.
After Halloween? What is it?
The dentist.
Good evening, scoundrels. Welcome to the humble home of the podcast that you see leering at you to your window at night, beckoning you to open it and let us in with our trance-inducing stare. I am Count Darth Taxus, your co-host, normally coming to you from the mausoleum of my flagship, the Assessor Collector. And joining me in this undertaking is the co-host and guy you're gonna call to chase away the blaze, Dennis, the Phantom's Menace, Keith. Dennis.
Taxus, thank you. Why am I talking like that? Hey, well, thanks for joining me here and leaving your normally comfy, cozy home on the flagship.
Boy, are my wings tired.
Right. And a special welcome to any of our new listeners. This is your first time listening to Starship Sabers and Scoundrels. Thanks for joining us. We hope you enjoy our special brand of Star Wars coverage. Well, with that out of the way, I guess we should get on to the news.
I think we have some trick-or-treaters.
Trick-or-treat!
Ah, what do we have here?
A stormtrooper. Very nice.
Hey, check out the Rey costume. Well done.
Oh, and a young Anakin in pod racer garb. That's great. Here, have an extra chocolate bar. In fact, take a few.
That is so wizard.
You know, you might not want to dish out so much at one time. This stuff is supposed to last us all night, and we've already indulged a bit.
What's the harm? What is the worst that could happen?
This show? Seriously?
Yeah. Good point.
Yeah, on with the news. All right, well, leading off the news, we asked for it and we got it. Now that the Darth Vader series has reached its conclusion, the further adventures of Dr. Aphra, Triple Zero, BT-1, and Black Chrysanthemum will be told in the pages of a new ongoing comic from Marvel entitled Dr. Aphra. This new series will make its debut this December with 2 issues. Taxus, I bet you are as pleased as I am.
I'm as happy as a little Sith. Okay, so 2 issues. Is that just coming out, like, they're not saying, it's a 2-issue run? Are they saying, like, it's just the first 2 issues are going to be released in December, back-to-back, bam-bam, pow-pow?
Yeah, you got it, bingo. They've already released the solicits for the January issue. It's a new ongoing series, and it's kind of like they did with Darth Vader when they had 2 issues come out real quick at the beginning. I'm assuming they're capitalizing on the excitement with the first issue by following it up really quickly with a second issue.
So I guess there's a lot of other people out there that are enjoying the adventures of Dr. Aphra. Not just us. You know, we are kind of trendsetters, Dennis. We're willing to say the hard things.
Right.
Like, we love Aphra.
I'm excited about this. This is kind of what I had alluded to in a couple of my past reviews of Darth Vader, that they really kind of need to pick up with a brand new character from the comics and go off in a series in that direction. Simply because with the classic trilogy characters, you're going to run out of time to tell stories.
Yeah.
And, you know, and the nice thing is with a character like Dr. Aphra, you don't have a predefined future for this character like you did Darth Vader and Luke and everyone else between New Hope and Empire Strikes Back. So they have the opportunity to tell some original stories and keep us in some suspense with these characters.
Right, because it's almost like what Joe likes to say in Brews and Blasters, where it's like some of the books are just feeling a little too cautious because they're afraid of stepping on the main storyline. And I guess that's one of the reasons why I really loved, like, the old Republic titles that Dark Horse ran, because there's so much empty space there to paint with. And in a way, now we can do it concurrent to this main storyline with Dr. Aphra and her adventures with the two psychotic droids.
Right. And the other thing about Dr. Aphra is that as this space archaeologist that specializes in technology, she's not really in it for the grand glory of the Empire or the Rebellion. So she doesn't have to engage in adventures that are going to shape the galaxy. So she's really got some room to grow and some room to have adventures of her own that we don't have to worry about, oh, well, how this affect the balance of power, like we do with Luke and Darth Vader. So.
Right. Well, some more news. In addition to a new trailer, Lucasfilm also released the new poster for Rogue One. None other than Gareth Edwards showed up on Star Wars Show 2 weeks ago to present the new poster. Like the poster for The Force Awakens, it is not a Drew Struzan piece. Instead, it features a pyramid of character faces and profiles with Jyn Erso featuring the most prominently in the middle. You know, besides depicting what sounds like a pyramid of heads with our Halloween theme, I really liked it. I thought it was really tasteful and well done. There's some that little imagery of, you know, the technical readouts on her face and everything. That was pretty cool. But that's been, you know, I know a lot of people probably talked about that to death. But yeah. So what about you? What do you think about this one? Is this going to be the grand theatrical trailer that's in theaters then?
I think so. Yeah, I really like it quite a bit. You know, at the bottom of that of the poster, it's got the walkers and the stormtroopers, kind of like that shot of them kind of combing the beach. I really like it quite a bit. I like this poster a lot better than the Force Awakens theatrical poster, which just looked a little too Photoshop to me. This one looks a bit more like a piece of art. It looks a lot more like. It gives me the same feeling as the classic posters for the original trilogy does when I look at that one. So it was well done. I really like the concept. It fits right in. I think it's a good transition poster between the prequel trilogy and the original trilogy.
What do you think about the way Krennic's portrayed on it versus then Vader and the Death Star?
I don't know that I really have too many thoughts on that.
Vader and the Death Star are kind of like... I mean, I'm thinking about like the Empire Strikes Back poster or a variant of it that I have where Vader's outline can be kind of faintly seen in the background, sort of menacingly. And that's kind of the same feeling.
Poster above my desk.
Oh, cool. Isn't that a good one?
Yeah, it is a good one. The movie is Krennic is the main villain in this one, or I believe he's supposed to be the main villain anyways. And, you know, we've all been kind of warned by Lucasfilm that Vader's in it, but he's probably not in it as much as we all want him to be in it.
Right.
But, I like it. It's a good poster. They did well. Now, related to that, they've since that poster was released, they've now teased all these character posters that they're putting out, which is, and they're all similar to what Jen looks like on this first theatrical poster. It's the character's head or upper body, and then you see the blueprints or the green technical schematics kind of like highlighted against their faces and bodies. Have you seen any of those?
No, I haven't yet. That sounds really cool. It's sort of like what they were doing with The Force Awakens with the what was that, the kind of map, you know, the tactical display.
Right. And, well, yeah. And it's, you know, it's a theme because they superimpose something like in front of the, you know, part of the character's faces. You know, Han Solo was his blaster, right. With Rey was her staff.
Yeah. That's right. And Leia was the technical display. That's right.
And then Finn had the lightsaber and stuff. So yeah, it's just, you know, secondary posters. They look nice, but I still think this new theatrical poster is my favorite.
Yeah. Cool. Looks really good.
In other news, the Rogue One soundtrack is now available for pre-order. The first live-action Star Wars film not to feature a score by John Williams will release the score on December 16th in conjunction with the release of the film. While it is currently available on Amazon.com for pre-orders, it is not yet available at outlets such as iTunes as of the time of this recording. So, I don't buy CDs anymore, so it's great that it's available on Amazon, but I am just going to wait for its availability on iTunes to get it. How about you?
I still gotta have the CD. I just like having it in my hand. You know, I don't know, there's something about it. And I got a little hot space opinion. I kind of like hearing the soundtrack before the movie comes out. I'm just gonna say that. It kind of builds the anticipation to me. Now, you know, there's the whole spoiler factor involved. But, maybe you could just release the tracks without any names on them, a special iTunes deal, and then when the movie comes out, then you can download all the track names, you know? I'm just going back. I really, really loved getting my hands on the soundtrack and really listening to the music. And then when I'm watching the movie, it kind of hits home a little more to me, like, oh, that's what this piece is for, or, you know, is behind it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. I think I remember with The Phantom Menace, at least my memory is, it's made it be faulty at this point, but you know, the Duel of the Fates, at least that one song came out well in advance of the movie. And, you know, I'm kind of wondering if with the director situation in this movie is if that maybe isn't a hindrance to doing it the way that you're suggesting, which is getting the soundtrack out in advance. I mean, I hate to gauge that kind of speculation because I think Giacchino will do a great job with this and stuff. But, you know, as I really enjoyed the Force Awakens soundtrack, and I listened to it quite a bit, I don't know that it really had that one standout piece that would rival something like the Imperial March or Duel of the Fates or something like that, that, you know, they could really get out there and get behind before the movie starts. So I don't know if that's the same case with Rogue One or what the situation is.
I thought now that I've listened to it a lot and I've seen the movie a lot, I thought that Rey's theme, you can kind of hear that a lot through the movie. You know,
right? But it's not, dun, dun, dun,
dun, you know.
Yeah, and it's catchy, but it is not. I need someone who's better at describing music than I am. But it's not the.
It doesn't have a driving or a big hook that really stands out there to you.
Yeah, there's that. I don't know. I mean, I could see a marching band playing it. You know, it's you know, the Imperial March. You know, it just. It that music really grabs you. It's bombastic. It's loud. And I like Rey's theme. Don't get me wrong. It just doesn't. It's not. It's just not as dominating as those other tracks that we mentioned.
But, yeah, that's a good point. Right.
Well, we got one last piece of news here, and this is last minute for us, but there's some casting news for the upcoming Han Solo film. The following was posted on StarWars.com earlier today. Lucasfilm announced today that Donald Glover, an acclaimed actor, award-winning writer, and Grammy-nominated artist, will be playing the part of Lando Calrissian in the still-untitled Han Solo Star Wars film, helmed by directors Phil Lord and Christopher Miller. Glover will join Alden Ehrenreich, previously cast as Han Solo, in bringing two iconic Star Wars characters back to the big screen, but at a time in their lives previously unexplored. So, yay. You know, that's been rumored for quite some time. It was much like, yep. You know, Alden Ehrenreich was cast and we all kind of knew it for a while and heard all the rumors and then it was formally announced. So I think this is news is kind of telling us what we already knew, but I think it is a welcome confirmation.
Yeah, I really don't know anything about the guy, to be honest with you. From what I hear, everybody tells me that he's great. And, you know, I'm sure they're very careful and selective in their casting, of course. Especially with these characters that, like we've discussed before, are so beloved, you know, by a wide range. So, yeah, okay. You know, well, I'm open-minded to it.
Yeah, you know, the thing is that I appreciate about the casting for this movie is that they're not going with completely unknowns, but they're not going with the biggest of names. And both Ehrenreich and Glover have a reputation of being extremely talented, and it seems like they're on the cusp of becoming some of the bigger names in Hollywood. This movie will certainly help that out, but it seems like they've really gone for quality and talent here. And so I'm excited for this movie. I think the casting is going to, it sounds great. You know, it's the Han Solo movie has got a lot of people concerned. You know, the most common complaint I hear is like, oh, no one asked for this. Well, whatever. But I think, you know, I didn't know it's necessarily that they needed Lando. I was kind of hoping this movie would focus on Han and Chewie, but, you know, no reason it couldn't have Lando, I suppose.
Have they announced a potential replacement for young Chewie, or?
No, I'm just assuming they're going to use the same actor that they used for The Force Awakens. No. That was kind of Mayhew's fill-in, and I can't think of his name off the top of my head.
Right. That's interesting. Well, you know, somebody was discussing this with me earlier, and they raised the point that this kind of feels like, I mean, in their mind, this was not something that needed to be done, you know?
Which, the movie or the casting of Lando?
The movie, period. Right. You know, it's like, is this just a way to reinforce the original trilogy characters to a new group of fans, you know?
I don't think so.
No.
I don't. I think this is, you know, Lawrence Kasdan has got a hand in writing this movie, and I'm excited for it. I think it's, you know, if you've got a great character and you've come up with a good adventure for him, then why not tell it? So you know, there could be any number of reasons for making this movie, and I'm really hoping that it is that they've come up with a good story for a good character. We'll see. But I don't think it is a, you know, we need to reintroduce audiences to this character or new audiences to this character, because people still watch the original trilogy in droves anyway.
Well, and I kind of hope it's not like, oh, so that's how he got the Millennium Falcon. You know, I kind of like leaving that more to lore, you know? The great
Sabacc
game.
Well, that's a good point. That's a good point. I mean, you know, I think through Legends, we've kind of filled in that he won the Falcon from Lando in a game of
Sabacc.
But who knows what it might be. And that we might see that here. And I think we're going to have to prepare ourselves for a number of things like that.
Well,
you know, stuff that were hinted in the past that maybe come out in this movie or not this movie, but, you know, a potential sequel.
Well, I hope it's the... It's been a long time. I'm sure he's forgotten about that by now. I hope it's that, you know,
right.
I hope
right.
that's the last time that they've seen each other before Cloud City, you know? So, well, we'll see what happens with it. Like I said, I'm open-minded with it, you know, I'll check it out, but, you know, I'm sure they're going to do a great job. It's just, I'm not as head over heels, and I probably will get a little bit more head over heels the closer we get to it. Cause I'm a sucker.
All right, well, I think that'll do it for this week's news. Is that what I think it is?
Yes, it is. Happy Halloween to you too, buddy.
Oh, wait. Yeah. Well, can you celebrate Halloween?
They sure do, Dennis. Isn't that right, Chewie? I hear you, big guy.
What did he say?
He said the holidays just aren't the same without Han this year, so he's making a big deal out of Halloween.
Oh, well, that does explain why he's dressed like Legolas.
No, I think that's Katniss Everdeen. Huh, that is weird. He says things on the Falcon have been kind of spooky lately. I know. Have some chocolate bars, big fella.
Hey, go easy on those. We need to make those last.
I'm just trying to cheer up a friend. Okay, Chewbacca, have fun trick-or-treating.
Yeah, well, okay, I think it's time for sky stalking.
I feel like we're being watched.
I am wondering, why are you here?
I'm looking for someone.
Looking? Found someone you have, I would say.
Okay, this is Sky Stalking. In this segment, Taxus is going to let us know where we can find all the Star Wars celebrities next month. So take it away, Taxus.
All right. Well, first up, we have Wizard World Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, November 4th through 6th. We've got Mr. Wookiee himself, Peter Mayhew, there. And then we have a whole slew of Star Wars-related artists, so I'm just going to read through the names. Blake Henriksen, Daniel Parsons, Joe Corney, Ken Kelly, Katie Cook. I really like Katie Cook's stuff too, by the way. Matt Hebb, Michael Golden, Rusty Gilligan, and Ron Frenz. So go on out there, buy some art, buy some pics, get some stuff signed. Next up, we got Fan Expo, whom I believe graciously invited us out to the Dallas Fan Days last weekend. And had a lot of fun, and I think we got some clips that we might roll on the upcoming show next time. Their show in Vancouver, Canada, November 11th through 13th. Another big one, Carrie Fisher. She's always super fun, so go out and see her. And, you know, why not? Good friend of Star Wars, Kevin Smith. And we have Greg Hyland, who is a Star Wars-related artist. And, you know, that's it.
All right. Well, that's our abbreviated version of Sky Stalking for November. Convention season is kind of wound down as
it's
we get
cold.
Closer to the holidays here. But as always, Scoundrels, if you meet one of the Star Wars celebrities, we'd love to hear about it. Send us your pictures, send us an email, and we can put those on our show. And, of course, we are at sqpod@retrozap.com. Oh, more trick-or-treaters.
Trick-or-treating! Wow, check out this Twi'lek. Nice Leku. How did you make them so...
Ow! Ichuta!
Oh, those are real.
You know, you're supposed to ask first. Cosplay is not consent.
Yeah, I just figured that out. And, hey, look at this Anakin from Attack of the Clones. Sorry, only one chocolate bar, please. We're trying to make these last.
What? It's not fair. And it's all Obi-Wan's fault. He's jealous, and he's holding me back.
What gives with that kid?
Teenagers.
To our hypothetical. For Halloween, we thought it would be fun to tackle something from the Star Wars universe that had the spirit of Halloween. Taxus and I brainstormed on it, and he suggested Death Troopers, the 2009 novel from Joe Schreiber. So, Scoundrels, as always, this will be a spoiler-filled discussion. We hope, if you're interested, you have already read the seven-year-old novel. Here's the synopsis from the cover flap. When the Imperial prison barge, the Purge, temporary home of 500 of the galaxy's most ruthless killers, rebels, scoundrels, and thieves, breaks down in a distant, uninhabited part of space, its only hope seems to lie with a Star Destroyer found drifting, derelict, and seemingly abandoned. But when a boarding party is sent to scavenge for parts, only half of them come back, bringing with them a horrific disease so lethal that within hours, nearly all aboard the Purge will die in ways too hideous to imagine. And death is only the beginning. The Purge's half-dozen survivors, two teenage brothers, a sadistic captain of the guards, a couple of rogue smugglers, and the chief medical officer, the lone woman on board, who will do whatever it takes to stay alive. But nothing can prepare them for what lies waiting on board the Star Destroyer amid its vast creaking emptiness that isn't really empty at all. The dead are rising, soulless, unstoppable, and unspeakably hungry. All right, so that is the basis for Death Troopers, which, you know, ironically, or not ironically, coincidentally, is now what the black clad stormtroopers in Rogue One are called. Mm-hmm. But so, yeah, this was Star Wars' first foray into the horror genre. And so that's why we picked it, obviously, for this Halloween special that we're doing. Mm-hmm. What'd you think, Taxus? What do you think of when you think about this novel?
Well, okay. I've always wanted to read this book. I never had gotten around to it. I read the sequel, Red Harvest, and thoroughly...
Which is actually a prequel.
Right. I guess in Star Wars sequel talk.
I'm right.
Confused now. But, and I gotta say that Joe Schreiber is... I forgot what a fun author he is. The book starts out fast, and it just doesn't let up. I mean, I think, you know, I'm still reading Bloodline. But this one, I was able to get through in like just a couple of days. From start to finish. And it really grabs your attention and doesn't let go. His descriptions are gory and great, you know? It's not for the faint of heart, I think. It's a horror novel, right?
Right.
It's the characters, I think, are somewhat engaging. They're fun.
Well, that's an interesting description. Fun.
You know, I mean, they're fun characters to be worried for.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Well, like, oh no. Right. You know, when you think, what's going to happen? You turn the page, you know? But yeah. So I really loved it. It really put me in a Halloween mood, to be honest with you.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've read this book at least three, if not four times. And then to prepare for this segment, I listened to the audio version of this book. And, you know, it's a Star Wars book. And with the exception of two, most of these characters you're never going to hear from again and right. Outside of this book, and in classic horror fashion, most of them get picked off one by one. And so there's some classic horror tropes in here with you know, in that regard, where the crew gets whittled down. You know, it's interesting, one of the comparisons that I come come to with this book is to Alien, in the fact that, you know, it takes place on board a starship, and you do kind of have this whittling down. So I guess it's actually more like Aliens with the sheer number of these people that get infected. And I guess we just should get into it. This disease that they're talking about, that they bring back from the Star Destroyer, you know, they send over some crew over there. They're looking for parts. They kind of split up. Some people get lost, and the captain gets, nervous. So he just says, they were given a time to get back. Right. They fell behind. They're staying behind. They return.
That's horror movie. That's horror movie rule number one. Don't split up.
Yep. And then, when they get back to the prison barge, everyone starts getting sick. And now it'd be just one thing if this disease were going around and killing people off. That'd be one genre, but it's effectively turning them into zombies, of a sort. And they, once they're zombified, they die, only to reanimate later and come after other people on board the starship. So what do you think of the Star Wars version of a zombie?
Real creepy. Okay, so I kind of had a heads up to some of the things because I had read the sequel prequel first. And I thought that scene when the Imperial Guard comes into the room that's full of the lungs and the larynx floating in some sort of fluid, and they all start screaming, I thought that was eerie. And just when they're on the Star Destroyer and you don't see anything, but you hear the scream,
That's a really great point, and that's another kind of horror element that we've got going. And instead of having a huge abandoned warehouse or a haunted house or a cave or something like that, which is the typical place that you'd find a horror movie occurring in, this place, you get this cavernous, gigantic Star Destroyer. And you're in the movies, you're used to seeing tons of officers and stormtroopers and everything running around these places. But then in this book, it's largely abandoned, and Schreiber does a great job with the setting the atmosphere. And there's echoing when they get into the main hangar, and they can barely see the roof of the hangar, and
they can barely see from one side of the hangar to the other.
Right. And there's just no activity going on there, except for them when they arrive. And then, they get into other large areas of the ship, and it's just abandoned. And on the audio version, they add enough audio cues, and I can't remember who read that book. I'd have to look that up. But they did just such a good job keeping it quiet in those parts, and so that you have the opportunity for your imagination to run wild on, what's going to be around that next corner. So they bring back the disease to the prison barge, and everyone dies off and then gradually turns into zombies, except for the Longo brothers, who are there because they got rounded up with their father. I think their father was a smuggler, and he gets killed off by the captain of the guard. And
they don't really describe what happened. You know what I mean? They unless I miss something, like, why did he end up getting killed by the captain of the guard?
I think it was supposed to be one part cruelty and a second part, just not cooperating. And three, the captain was trying to achieve something and he couldn't get it. And so there's frustration. Yeah. But so you have the Longo brothers, then you have the captain who survives without getting infected on the barge. You have the chief medical officer, Zahara Cody, that was the lone woman that was on the ship. And then you get the notorious pair of scoundrels and smugglers in the galaxy, Han and Chewie, are there on that barge. And they are not initially infected because they're in solitary confinement.
Yeah, I thought that was a great touch.
Right. And so when Dr. Cody figures out that she's immune, her medical droid creates a vaccine from her antibodies, which she uses to basically vaccinate Han and Chewbacca. So that's kind of our survivors group for this for this story.
What do you think of Chewbacca's little dreamscape piece? But I mean, I guess I didn't quite understand what was his whole life day thing? Was it trying to make him... Was the disease trying to... Which the disease to me is sentient. Like, it's almost like a yes. hive mentality. Like, it's...
In a way.
Yeah, it's spreading intentionally and linking up. It's not just mindless, individualistic zombies kind of walking around. It's like a collective, almost, of them all.
Right. The way they describe the disease in the book is a couple aspects. First, when it infects someone, the disease is large. It's not dormant. It's spreading from cell to cell, but doesn't really activate and become lethal until it's so becomes so invasive that the immune system has no chance of fighting it off. Right. And then it and that's why, you know, everyone kind of died off, but then they all kind of turned into zombies at the same time. Mm-hmm. And then, like you mentioned, there is kind of this hive consciousness that comes with the virus. And so these zombies kind of all act in a coordinated manner, which will figure into the conclusion of this book, which we'll get to in a minute. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the disease was quite creepy. You know, at one point, the two brothers are Trig and Kale Longo, and Kale, they're initially immune, which is they just can't get it in the airborne old-fashioned that right. most of the people on the barge does. But later, Kale gets bitten by mm-hmm. one of the zombies.
By his dad. Infected.
Oh, was it his dad? I couldn't remember who it was. And he gets bitten in the leg, and that disease basically then grabs a hold of him there and spreads up his body. He's on board the Star Destroyer with Dr. Cody, and she's trying to prevent the spread of the disease. And that is one of that part there creeped me out more than anything else. Yeah. In this book. Especially the audio version. And to kind of keep this on the PG level, you know, she basically has to perform some on the spot surgery without anesthesia.
It's like an alien C-section.
Right. And, you know, this disease is kind of squirming up to this kid. And, yeah. And so she kind of goes in after it. And
I bet it made wet noises, too. Like,
yeah. She's like pulling out. And, anyway, moving on. So, yeah, there's that. Well, and then, you know, and then in classic space horror fashion, you know, now they've got everyone that survived is kind of trying to get away. How do you escape this thing? And as it turns out, the barge was not only was it breaking down, but it was basically pulled out of hyperspace by the tractor beams on the Star Destroyer. And the Star Destroyer is essentially disabled. It's just floating there and it's got its tractor beams going. But, you know, they don't have anything they can use on the barge to get away. So the survivors all make their way up to the Star Destroyer to try and figure out an escape.
Right, right. And, you know, just could you imagine just the confusion and bewilderment of trying to find your way through something like that. I liked, we talked about the cavernous, you know, opening the hangars, but I thought it was kind of interesting with the ships kind of strewn around, you know? Mm-hmm. And at first I was kind of like, well, okay, sure, there's some ships strewn around, but later it comes into play in an important way, especially since we discover that not only do these... Does this disease communicate with each of its hosts, but it has a tendency to learn and
right.
And so, it's, there are times where it's figured out that, you know, they figure out how to shoot blasters, you know, they're not as accurate at first, but they seem to get tighter and tighter as the learning curve goes on. And then, you know, when they see the captain figure out how to blow a ton of them away with a X-wing blaster cannon, then all of a sudden they all start scrambling for the ships, you know, to use those as right. well. And that's what they were using, the tractor beam. They figured out how to activate the tractor beam to bring ships in.
Exactly. And the thing that's about that, because the captain finds himself in the hangar, Captain Tartarus.
Yeah.
You know, he's got these zombies chasing him, so he jumps into this X-Wing and uses the turbo, you know, the blasters on it to fire some of them, and he ends up, you know, kind of rocking that X-Wing up against an Imperial shuttle, which gets into another creepy element of this book.
Yeah.
So he scrambles out of the X-Wing and he heads towards the shuttle, and he finds some survivors from the Star Destroyer that are aboard the shuttle. And so he's kind of talking to them about what's going on, and it's the commander of the... of the shuttle, Commander Gorister, that's explaining what they've learned, that, you know, this virus is here on board, and that the zombies, you know, they eventually figure things out, and they observed him using the blasters on the X-Wing, so now they're trying to turn weapons on the shuttle, because in the past they just kind of all swarmed over the shuttle and rocked it for a bit, and then they gave up because they couldn't get the people inside.
Right.
And so Captain Sartorius notices that, wow, these surviving Imperials aboard the shuttle had to have been here for a while, and they're awfully thin.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's simply because their only way of sustaining themselves is to resort to cannibalism. And yeah, so they draw lots and eat the people on board one by one as they're trying to figure out how to get off the Star Destroyer.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, not even cooked.
No. Well, and so you got that element. And so, you know, the story moves along. There's a bit of a redemption for Sartorius. He realizes that, you know, he commandeers an escape pod from the Longo brothers. You know, Kale eventually succumbs to the zombieism, and you know, so he, you know, there's no recovering him. You know, Han and Chewie help Trig and Dr. Zahara Cody get away, or working on getting away. And when Satoru had used an escape pod, he got sucked back up into the hangar, which is why he didn't found the X-Wing.
Yeah, that was a cool element, because I was wondering, right, how is he going to get on the Death Star, or the Star Destroyer? And
right.
One of the things I really like, we're talking about creep factor. Mm-hmm. The piles of bodies in that, yes, room that Trig finds, and he's got to start climbing over them when he gets chased.
By essentially his brother.
By his brother.
His yeah, zombie brother.
Yeah. And then the other thing I thought was really, really creepy was when Dr. Cody goes into the med lab and finds the two zombies kind of hanging by all these cables and stuff, you know, that mm-hmm, were intentionally inserted into their bodies from the ceiling. And whenever the air system pumped air into there, all of a sudden, I mean, because, like, basically they're almost completely decayed in their faces. You can't see, there's no eyes, there's nothing. But when they smell her through the ventilation, their heads snap up and they start, mm-hmm, they start swinging and start slamming against the glass, the swing. Oh god, that's just so creepy.
Well, you know, one of the creepiest moments for me, it was before they got off of the barge. I think it was the brothers found a cell that had some Wookiees in it, and most of the, yeah, Wookiees were deceased except for a child, and they got attracted to that cell because they heard that the Wookiee child crying and mewling, and so they went in to see what was going on. They tried to convince this child to leave them, and they couldn't do it, and the Wookiee kid just kept going back to its deceased family, and he was trying to snuggle up with them, and at one point he sat down in one of the Ted Wookiee's laps and wrapped his arm around him, and as they're leaving, they could hear the Wookiee crying, and then all of a sudden it stopped, and they could hear something like it was being eaten.
Yeah.
And so the implication being that, you know, one of those dead Wookiees awoke as a zombie and then started, yeah, chomping on the kid.
Yeah. And that's another creepy element. Whenever all of a sudden they realized all the bodies were missing.
Right. Yeah. They, you know, they turn around, all of a sudden the bodies are gone, and, you know, they've all shuffled off together, and then they, you know, in mass, move on.
Yeah.
You know, look on to the survivors.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, returning to the plot here. So, the, so they've deactivated, Han and Chewbacca figured out how to deactivate the tractor beam so they can get away. And the zombies, as you mentioned earlier, have learned some things. And so they start piling, crowding into ships and start trying to leave the Star Destroyer, the idea that they're going to go other places and start affecting worlds. And then the resolution of this crisis ends up being that they have to stay in a proximity to the source of the virus, because it's this communal thing. And when they get too far away, it shuts down. And
yeah,
so it's kind of a failsafe for this Blackwing virus is what, yeah, it's called.
Yeah, because that's what the Empire had, I guess, atomized it somehow, mm-hmm, to make it basically weaponizing it, and apparently this came from, in the story, Vader himself was, gave the orders for the operation.
No, I didn't recall that, but that's cool.
And it was called, it was called the Vector. The Star Destroyer is called the Vector, and I was trying to remember if that rang a bell with anybody.
No, not with me. But this novel, it had a it had an impact on the Star Wars galaxy, the greater Star Wars galaxy, in the Legends era for a time. Did you ever get the chance to play Star Wars Galaxy, the original MMORPG?
No, I didn't.
Okay. Well, I was a big fan of that game, and I played it quite a bit. And they had a an event where this Blackwing virus, canisters of it, landed on Dathomir, and that was a planet. It's a little different than what we know it as now, but there was a segment of that planet that got quarantined because there's these canisters of this virus start exposing people to the virus, and so you had this segment of Dathomir that was overrun by zombies and death troopers. Mm-hmm. And so you would have the opportunity to coordinate with other players and do missions trying to into this base that had been overrun by these zombies. They took it to a whole new level, though. There was a zombified Rancor in this which was incredibly challenging to get to and defeat. And then even more recently in the mobile game Star Wars Commander, at Halloween, they've traditionally been doing a Death Trooper event that you can recruit Death Trooper characters to attack your other players and stuff that. And I just saw an email about that the other day. So before we wrap this up, did you have any other thoughts on Death Troopers?
Yeah, I've kind of been thinking through this, and I guess I'm just pulling some things from a few different sources here. But one of the things you noted at the very beginning is they do share the same name with these mysterious stormtroopers we see that Director Krennic uses in Rogue One. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of also, one of the things I'm always wondering about when I'm thinking about Rogue One, well, how come we haven't seen this afterwards? Or how come we don't see this later, so to speak? And then when some of the retrozappers were going over the Death Trooper helmets and how they've got this faint green glow in the, I don't know what you would call those two items protruding through down at the base of the mask, if you know what I'm talking about.
Right.
And how all the Death Troopers are kind of really, really tall and angular, you know what I mean? Like very...
Right.
It almost seems a little odd. Well, now, who else had some sort of green glowing to them in the Star Wars universe? And thinking about the Night Sisters and the magic that they will. And what did their magic do? Their magic could raise the dead. Right?
So you're really linking up a whole bunch of different things.
I am. And I'm just wondering if somehow they've captured the ability to harness that energy, in that the suit is keeping the trooper alive, who is not necessarily a zombie, but somehow being, because we do know that the Night Sisters had zombies, that they raised in defense, and that's canon.
Interesting. Well, that's an interesting theory.
Yeah, it's complete speculation, but I'm just saying, where have I seen this green glowing before?
Well, why are they calling them
Death Troopers?
Well, I think it's supposed to be, a fierce name for a hit squad. Mm-hmm. It's Krennic's personal things. I don't mean to squash completely this thing, because why would I know? That just seems, it seems awfully detailed and awfully nuanced for a movie that seems to be more about getting the plans for the Death Star. But, you never know. That's certainly a possibility.
Yeah. It's just fun to think through that. I mean, that's kind of part of the fun of all this before movies come out. What ifs? Not necessarily spoilers, it's speculation.
Exactly. All right. Well, I think that will do it for our first hypothetical. More trick-or-treaters. Whoa, that has got to be the biggest ghost I have ever seen.
Wait, is that Jabba under there?
Looks like it.
He wants 50 pieces of candy?
50 pieces? And you speak Huttese now?
Yeah, it's like a romance language.
Yeah. Well, we don't have 50 pieces left.
He says he'll settle for 35. And I do suggest we give it to him.
Okay, guess we better do it. Well, we have one left. I hope we don't get too many more trick-or-treaters. This could be a problem. All right, so yeah, now we got rid of those trick-or-treaters. Thought maybe we'd spend a little time talking about some of our own Star Wars Halloween-related experiences. And with that, I'll give you the floor first, Taxus.
All right, well, I guess I'll go way back in time. And I know that Rich Woloski had recently written an article about the Ben Cooper costumes.
Right.
And I was the proud owner and wearer of a Ben Cooper Stormtrooper costume. To be honest with you, I'd forgotten all about it until I read that article. And I was just kind of like, oh my gosh. Oh yeah, it's flooding back to me now. I remember glow sticks, I think, were kind of a recent phenomenon as well. And I remember that bad-fitting mask because of the single strand of elastic was barely keep it over my huge head. And then for some reason I thought it'd be really cool to like stick a couple of glow rods in my cheeks while I'm doing it. So that just made it even worse. That was a long time ago. Back, I want to say maybe 1979, something mm-hmm. like that. 78, 79, if I remember.
Yeah,
I remember the thing didn't last very long either.
Right. Just kind of fell apart. I also had a Ben Cooper. I had C-3PO. That was the one that I remember wearing. I think it was in first or second grade when I got that thing. And at the time, that's what you had for costumes. You know, it was a plastic mask with a band that held it on your face, and then you were essentially wearing what looked like a smock, an apron.
With a picture of the character you're depicting.
Yeah, it wasn't, you either had Darth Vader's big face on there, or you had a big depiction of C-3PO and Star Wars written mm-hmm. there. So, no one could possibly confuse what it was you were dressed up with. But that's what we had at the time, and we loved it. I get jealous. Yeah, because my kids have been Stormtroopers and Clone Troopers and Darth Vader, and their version of the costumes have been phenomenal.
Like film accurate.
Yeah, and right. Yoda ears and all kinds of stuff, so that they can. I don't know about film accurate, but it's a whole lot more impressive than what we had. But like I said, we didn't know any better back in the day.
Oh yeah, and I swear I probably have so much lung damage from opening plastic items back then and taking a giant whiff once you open the box. I just remember that real heavy. I'm not even sure what plastic it was, but what I'm talking about, that odor that just hits you whenever you mm-hmm. open up something new like that. It's those are really fun. And I guess you're right, it's just our imaginations were the best thing that we had with it. I think later I got a, not the suit, but just the mask. I think they sold the masks separately at some point.
Right.
And then I had the Boba Fett and the I had a Luke, which was odd. I don't know.
A Luke. Yeah. That was always funny because they'd give you a mask, which is basically a person's face. And it's not necessarily that mask made you look any more like that person, because the mask didn't, the Luke didn't really look like Mark Hamill.
No, but for some reason I enjoyed wearing it around people.
Okay. Well, last year I had the opportunity to go to Rancho Obi-Wan's gala, and the theme that year was Galloween. So they had some trick-or-treat Halloween-type theme things going on there at the party, but they also had Alex Ware there, who is online as the Pumpkin Geek. You can go to thepumpkingeek.com. And while the early part of the evening was going on and there was cocktails being served and some hors d'oeuvres, he was taking those plastic polyurethane pumpkins and creating Star Wars jack-o'-lanterns out of them. And then they were all auctioned off later in the evening during the live auction. And oh, cool. So there was a, you know, I think, yeah, I'm trying to remember all the ones he did. I know there was a cat. I think there was a Captain Phasma. There was a Kylo Ren, R2-D2, BB-8, Boba Fett, and I think maybe some X-Wings. But they would auction off one of these every few items. And one of the earlier ones was Darth Vader. And I won it at the auction. And so that's what cool. I've got set up for trick-or-treating this year. And I was fortunate because I got it before everyone really got warmed up on the bidding. And so I'm not going to say what I paid for it at the auction, but it was about 40% of what most of the other pumpkins went for, simply because people just kind of hadn't warmed up and gotten into the, you know, the thrill of right. the auction and the chase there.
So you're able to snag it. Yeah.
And then he was nice enough to ship it to me, so I didn't have to try and take it back from San Francisco on the plane. But most of my other Halloween decorations sit in the garage. This one stays up in my office until it's time closer to Halloween. Then I'm going to, you know, put it back down on the ledge inside so no one can wander off with it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And, so did, were there a lot of people in costume and stuff there?
Not really. You know, they had more decorations for Halloween than people really dressed up for it. And, you know, most people just kind of showed up in Star Wars t-shirts and things like that. Trying to think, Steve Sansweet was dressed up as a wolf, Commander Wolf from cool. Clone Wars. And that's right after that episode of Rebels came out with where they went and found Rex and the other clones on that planet. So it was a nice little cosplay that he had going on there at the end of the evening.
So fast forwarding in time now, with you happen to mention like the costumes looking a lot better. Mm-hmm. I had a lot of fun a few years ago, and my girls wanted to dress up like their characters from Star Wars The Old Republic online.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and one was, I'm trying to remember, my oldest was a Jedi Merallian. Am I saying that name right? You know, green skin, tattoos on the nose.
Oh, yeah. Right. Like Barisophy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then my youngest one be a Cathar. And so we did her up to look like a cat. And in her Jedi costume. And one of the things I really like about those costumes, and to be honest with you, this probably embarrasses the heck out of them now, but I like using the lightsabers as a traffic control device.
That's a good one.
It lets cars see where you're at. It's like a giant glow rod, you know? Sure. Now, of course, you know, they're gonna go, Dan, do you have to have that on all the time? Yes, I do. You know, and
well, let me ask you before we wrap up this segment here. If you could go back and do it all over again as a kid, a teenager, whatever, and you could dress up as any Star Wars character you wanted, given the, you know, the plethora of props and costumes and things that are available today that weren't available when we were kids that were trick or treating, who would you dress up as?
Oh, you know, I'm going to say Han Solo.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna go with. I think, and you know, granted, it wasn't released when we were kids, but the I really liked his costume from The Force Awakens. I think I'd do that. And
yeah, that's cool.
Second place, I'd pick either Darth Vader or Kylo Ren.
Yeah,
you know, there's just some really great costumes for those characters now these days.
Oh yeah, that's wonderful. But you know, everybody knows the scariest Star Wars character dress up as, right?
And what's that?
Jar Jar, right?
All right. That'll do it for this hypothetical segment.
All right. That is the biggest Power Ranger I have ever seen.
Something about him seems familiar. It's like... Well... I guess we better give him some candy.
Yeah. About that.
Taxus, are you okay?
Give him some candy.
Where's that last chocolate bar?
They
ate it. You ate it? Taxus, what? Here, a bag of M&M's. Please, take it. You okay, Taxus?
Yeah. Hey, we got any more of them chocolate bars lying around? I'm kind of hungry.
Chewy. 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 Yeah, it's really me, buddy. Yeah, I'm glad to see you too. Of course, I can always see you. All the time. Yeah, I'd rather forget that. Yeah, that was tough. But now I'm just hanging around doing ghost things. Like saying boo a lot. Oh, and I also like scaring the crap out of Lando. Last time I scared him so bad, he exploded worse than a Tabana gas mine. Yeah. But hey, buddy. I have something serious I need you to do. Are you at my computer? I need you to find a file called Fantasy Hotball. There's something in there I need you to take care of. No, not that. It's a will. Yeah, I need you to deliver it to Leia. You might not want to read it. Yeah, about that. I come from a rich family of Corellian shipbuilders. I'm kind of a trust fund baby. I didn't tell anyone because, you know, money, friends. But we still had good times, right, pal? Don't worry, I made sure you're taken care of. Yeah, so the money goes to Leia, Ben, and my other kid, Finn. Yeah, just think about it. You'll figure it out. I made sure to take care of you too. You get free haircuts at my favorite barber. Yeah. Well, I gotta go. Just deliver that. Okay? Ooh. You kids get off.
All right, it's that time. It's time for
Silence, Fools!
Well, first up, we received a rather long but quite excellent email from our friend Rezekai. Here are some of the highlights. He starts with, "Hey, Scoundrels, it's Rez again. I'm glad to hear you keeping a consistent podcast about our favorite galaxy far, far away. I had a blast listening to your conversation with Mike Tarkin McDonald from the Sandcrawler podcast talk about your favorite action figures. As a huge action figure enthusiast, I was really excited to hear what your favorite action figures and collectibles were. Hearing Taxus talk old school vintage with most of his list really hit the nostalgia strings. You both had some really great choices in action figure collectibles. With the spirit of this conversation in mind, I'll relay you my own favorite 3.75 action figures from the vintage lines to the more modern versions of Star Wars." And this is, he's got some great descriptions here, but we're just going to kind of count down the first few here. Number five, he's got the Imperial Officer from 1980, Empire Strikes Back.
I like what he says. It does what it needs to do. Just stand there and get force choke. Right. Calls him a rebel scum.
Number four is the Power of the Force 2 Luke Bespin Thick Teagues from Empire Strikes Back 1998 with the hidden removable hand. I'm not familiar with that one myself, but that sounds cool. Number three is the Vintage Collection Boba Fett Empire Strikes Back from 2012, 3.75.
Cool.
Number two is it's a much more recent character, the Black Series Rey from The Force Awakens 2015, 3.75. And then before he gets to one, he gave us a few honorable mentions. Sidano Othano, otherwise known as the Crimson Corsair, from the 2016 Force Awakens 2-pack. Jabba the Hutt from 2014's Return of the Jedi Rancor Pit set. There's a Toys R Us exclusive, actually.
Oh, yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, I think I've seen that one before. And then the AT-AT driver from Empire Strikes Back. That's one that I was very fond of. Talked about action figures in that last episode, good choices there.
They are, but his number one, and I have to say this is kind of a cool one, 30th anniversary Suntir Fell comic 2-pack with the TIE pilot outfit from 2007. And he says about it, While I had thought about Farm Boy Luke in some iteration for my number one, I had to go with my Imperial brethren and pick the character that made me rethink how the Imperials served. My father himself was drafted in the service in 1969 and served in Vietnam. Thank him for his service. When I look back at the story that ties Suntir Fell, Dark Horse Comics Rogue Squadron number 25, The Making of Baron Fell, to the main saga, and how he was a man of ideals and principles drafted into serving a machine that, while he didn't agree with how their policies were executed, wanted to keep peace and order for others to prosper. I can't help but think of how many other stories on the Imperial side could be told without them turning into scum and terrorists like the Rebels. General Veers, anyone? But that's a conversation for another day. Needless to say, Fell holds a place in this dark heart. Man, that's a good pick. That's a good strong. I like that.
Yeah, I've never seen that action figure. I mean, I know who Suntir Fell is, and I'm somewhat familiar with his story. But that's a different one. You know, we got a lot of response online, especially through Twitter. Mm-hmm. We asked people to tweet pictures of some of their favorite action figures to us, and we got quite a nice response. So thank you to all the Scoundrels for that.
I remember seeing these packs, and even though this was kind of during my dark period, I remember thinking to myself, oh, that's a really cool looking action figure, you know? Mm-hmm. And now, I mean, if you follow like the Legacy line of Dark Horse Comics, Baron Fell and ends up becoming the new Emperor, if I remember correctly, and forms like the Imperial Knight. Was he not force sensitive? Am I remembering that correctly?
I don't think he was. Okay. I recently reread Spectre of the Past and Vision of the Future, and he had a number of clones that ended up helping out the Republic.
Was it Baron Fell that became the Emperor, or one of his offsprings?
I thought that was an Imperial Guard of some kind.
Oh.
Maybe we're talking about two different stories. Hmm. But,
Because I thought Emperor Fell eventually was the one with the Imperial Knights and all that stuff, which...
I'm sorry. I know who you're talking about now. Yeah. We're talking about two different eras. Yes, yeah. Their descendant was an emperor. Yes, there was a couple of different Fells that became emperors of the Reformed Empire in the Dark Horse comic series. I was thinking of the books that had a similar name. But yes, he had the Imperial Knights you said that jogged my memory.
That's a cool storyline. If you can find it, go reread it out of the Legends. It's really fun. Right. Also, I just like the Imperial Knights. Sorry, I thought that was a good idea. But
are we to believe that, because I know Jaina Solo married Fell's son in the Legends universe.
Oh yeah.
And so was that supposed to be the introduction of, you know, how some Fells became force sensitive? You know, was their descendants?
Maybe that's it. I just seem to remember the Emperor being, because his daughter, I think, was also force sensitive. So yeah, that's quite possible that they were.
That was always my understanding of what happened, but I don't know that they ever explicitly said that. So anyway.
Well, maybe we'll research it. Maybe not. Who knows?
Right.
Somebody can tell us. All right. Well, he's got one more very important, I'd like to say possibly the most important piece of this email. And he says, lastly, I wanted to include a shout out to the now proven prophet of the future, Darth Taxus. You're still nice to Dennis, by the way, he adds, who correctly foretold a Dr. Aphra spinoff series as she takes her archaeology skills on space lanes throughout the Star Wars galaxy, traveling to ancient Sith ruins and forgotten outposts from a letter I wrote back many episodes ago. She's a true Dr. Jones of the Star Wars universe. Even Kieran Gillen confirmed it, if we ever saw one. My helmet's off to you, sir. Thank you, Rezekai. And I'll keep foretelling the future. With a modest amount of accuracy, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, you know what they say about pundits is that they only have to be right like once every four or five times, and everyone remembers that. So
I'm like the Nostradamus of Star Wars fandom.
Yeah. Well, that was a great email from Rezekai. So that sure was. That was very much appreciated, and we appreciate all the thought and you put into that one, because that was a rather lengthy email. So yeah. Again, thanks.
Thanks a lot, bud.
And that will do it for our Silence Fool segment this week. Oh, what a Halloween. Looks like you finally recovered from that choking, Taxus.
Well, given the jokes on this show, I don't think I'll ever recover.
Yeah. Anyway, well, that was a fun show to put together. Some Rogue One, Dr. Aphra, Han Solo news, some Death Troopers discussion, and plenty of Halloween hijinks.
Yeah, it was like the trick-or-treating on the street that gives out the full-size chocolate bars. Just like we do, Dennis.
Uh-huh.
Before we sign off, here's how you can find us on social media. The show can be found on Twitter at @SCubedPod. I am at Darth Taxus, and Dennis can be followed on, or at DJKVER2. We are also on Facebook. We can be found there at facebook.com/SCubedPod.
Scoundrels, we could really use your iTunes reviews. I know everyone asks for them, and they can be a pain, but they do help others find the show. So if you have a moment, we'd appreciate a review anywhere you can leave one, whether it's iTunes or Stitcher or Google Play. We'll read good reviews on the show. Also, if you get the chance, share our show posts on Twitter or Facebook. Let others know you're listening. Thanks to everyone that has been doing that. It's very much appreciated. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In addition to social media, you can reach us by email at sqpod@retrozap.com. Have a good Halloween story? What did you think about the Death Troopers novel? Let us know. The best emails, which is almost all the emails, end up in Silence Fools. Again, that email address is sqpod@retrozap.com.
Speaking of RetroZap.com, we are honored to be part of the RetroZap.com podcast network. Please check out RetroZap for our other great shows, including Brews and Blasters, The ArgCast, The DeuceCast Movie Show, DuneCast, Skywalking Through Neverland, Talking Apes TV, Techno Retro Dads, The Trade Federation, We Know Nothing, The Animaniacast, Beltway Banthas, and The Sandcrawler.
And this week, a special thank goes out to Aaron Lay for our show logos. Also, a warm welcome to RetroZap to James Volpe, also known as the Sky Geek. You can find his first contribution, Zubio Has a Posse, on RetroZap. And additional thanks to Jeremy Hunt, Emily Person, my wife and children, for supplying additional voices for this episode. And here is our legal disclaimer. Starships, Sabers, and Scoundrels is not endorsed, affiliated with, or sponsored by Lucasfilm and Disney. The show is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only. All characters, music, and sounds are the intellectual property of their respective copyright holders, and all else is the intellectual property of Starships, Sabers, and Scoundrels, unless otherwise indicated. Wow. Well, any final thoughts, Taxus?
Yeah. We hope you don't think this podcast sucks.
Alrighty then, that'll do it for this episode of Starship Sabers and Scoundrels. Happy Halloween. Thanks for listening, everyone, and we'll catch up with you next time. May the Force be with you.
You should have a happy Halloween, Orky Day.